Hi, I'm David Eskenazi. Today we're joined for a conversation with Oana Stanescu, who's a founder of Family in New York City. The name of your practice, Family, which seems pretty significant. How did it kind of happen and why did you guys pick Family?
Family is a partnership between Dongping Wong and myself. We met about 11 years ago and we met working together. And the way we work too, we disagree a lot and we kind of fight a lot in a productive way. So when he was going through names, there were a lot of really crazy ones. I wish I could remember them, but it's probably for the better that I don't. But the moment he said Family, we both said, okay, that's it. There was kind of no question. And I think that kind of thing applies to our work too. Like, we fight a lot, but when the project reaches the point, that sweet spot when everything falls into place, we both shut up. There's nothing to argue about anymore, it just feels right. We felt in a way that we were stuck with each other, for better or worse. And you know, you can fight all you want all day or disagree or argue, but at the end of the day, you're still kind of having dinner together.
Who do you guys feel like is part of that family? Like, does it extend to maybe your collaborators that you guys are working with? Family seems like, it's interesting, it's like an inclusive term and doesn't have like maybe a clear-cut boundary.
Yeah,
you know?
I will stick to the non-clear-cut boundary.
Yeah.
I think that's part of the beauty. I think collaborators are important to us. Our employees, of course, the larger the family, the better in a way. The one thing that was always important to us with people that we work, whether it's client, collaborator, is that we do feel there's a connection there. If you have different expectations, you could easily meet people to whom you say red and then they understand blue. If that's the case, then the whole process isn't gonna work out, because designing something for someone is kind of a very, I would say also a very intimate and vulnerable type of process. So it's important that the people that we work with in whatever capacity do understand that, and there's a kind of mutual respect and openness. So in that sense, I do think everyone we touch with becomes part of the family.
Is there something about that that maybe is like a lesson, like a new way of thinking about practice, like for other architects? It seems like the figure of the architect is always kind of like a single person, and it seems like to sort of pull away from that and call it a family suggests a different kind of practice.
I think our generation and the generations to come are definitely challenging that notion of the genius sketch, if you will, and the kind of one single author of architecture. I mean, we particularly were not interested in that. I get excited by working with other people and by communicating with other people and getting ideas from them. People that we work with, friends, family basically, that inspire and help a project move forward. One thing that happened organically for us, we were early on exposed more to different fields or networks rather than architects, not intentionally, it just so happened. So we were being exposed to musicians or artists or kind of other fields. We draw a lot of inspiration from there. We try to constantly learn from other people, no matter what they do, because I think there's a lot of crossover and within the creative fields. We're in an interesting moment in time where things are slowly changing, and I feel there's this generation of younger offices, and I'm looking even at students and kind of expecting to see how they're challenging the norms.
That's interesting that you're sort of seeing it both in people that influence you like in other fields, but now you're also noticing it with your students.
That's why I like teaching, right? Because I want to learn from them, and I expect them to challenge us, whoever you call us, the faculty, the anyone who walks in there. I mean, they're the next generation. It's always the generations to come that are going to make the difference. So I think there's a lot of room for improvement in the field.
When you guys start a project, it seems like some of your projects, you guys are self-initiating them, like the plus pool. You guys like were like, we want to do this, and you made it happen, which is amazing, and not the usual way that architects get work. You like decided to just make work for yourself. How much does like the circumstance of how you get the project influence the way that you guys think about it as a design proposal?
That's a good question. I'm gonna focus on the pool as a kind of case study. It's kind of our biggest baby, one of our probably most important ones, or dearest, let's put it like that. In a way, it really reflects on every single aspect what we want the practice to stand for. And it came about back in the day when we were just starting the office and didn't really have a lot of responsibility. And it was early on, and it was literally trying to make work for us, not out of boredom, but it was really as basic as, why can't we just swim in this river? You know how hot and gross New York gets in the summer. And Manhattan is an island, and you really have no relationship to the water. You completely forget it. And you're like, really, we should be able to swim. Like, it's crazy that people were able to do this up to 100 years ago. And then we're just like the kind of We just thought it was hilarious to have a plus-shaped pool, which seems completely counterintuitive to what a pool is supposed to be, but we found a lot of purpose in that, in the sense that New Yorkers can be very demanding. So we, by making a plus-shaped pool, each of the four pools basically can cater to someone else. So you can have your kids' pool, your lab pool, your lounge pool. And the crux of it is too, for a young office, you don't really have a lot of options. You can do competitions. For RFPs, you need developers, or it's kind of quite a build-up to even get there. If we were to wait for someone to approach us, to ask us to do the world's first water-filling floating pool, it would have been a really long wait. So then that begs the question, well, shouldn't there be a process where you're not really always waiting or depending on a client? Like, shouldn't we have some agency too? Because to me, that's what architectural design does at its best. It makes a difference in ways in which the people who sometimes hold the key to architecture, meaning budget, policy, so on and so forth, don't necessarily have the vision for it. So to me, architecture and design at its best is a process, it's a discovery process that can lead to really amazing things and considerably improve our time spent on this planet. Again, I'm looking at the next generations to come too, more and more, to have this reverse process where you're not just sitting and waiting for something to happen, but just go out there. And I think that's one aspect that was always interesting to us. How can you change the process in which architecture is being traditionally done?
It's not something that we often, at least in schools, like here at SCI-Arc, it's hard to sort of simulate practice. Is there a way that you manifest that sense of, let's say, curiosity or ingenuity with like your students, that they have to kind of figure out how to make something happen without you giving them too many parameters?
Like, it's something I'm exploring. I'm hoping I'm able to do that. I'm still kind of experimenting or learning, but it's something that's important to me because, you know, as architects, we're not specialists into anything. We're generalists. We're being exposed to a set of skills, and some are gonna suit us better than others, but we're not great at one specific thing, right? You're not a brain surgeon. To me, actually, the essence of a master's school is, it's gonna sound cheesy, but getting the students to know themselves, for them to come out as people with opinions and a clear attitude as to what they stand for. I think more often than not, unfortunately, people are very vague about what they care about or what they stand for good reason. It's a complicated field, to say the least. But their formation as independent people who stand for something is something that's really most important to me. You know, designing is a really personal kind of process. How much of it can you teach? The way I always think about it is you expose students to something that you're doing, and hopefully they're able to pick from there what's interesting to them. But I think that's important that they understand you're looking at a range of perspectives. There's no singular perspective when it comes to architecture. Hearing their own voice, kind of having them have a little bit of fun with it in a looser way, because it is deeply intimate.
Could you tell us a little bit about like how that openness that you're describing about fostering that creativity, like the plus pool, for example, you know, it's a diagram and an icon at the same time. There's always this sense of keeping it so that anybody can kind of keep it in their minds. Do you think that that's something that you guys are conscious of at the beginning of starting a project? Like, you're open with yourselves, but is there a sort of a reading or an idea about how these forms go into the world and the way that people might think of them?
It's always interesting to hear someone else describe your own work to you, because when we work, or you know, you don't rationalize it, it's kind of intuitive. Plus pool is one of those rare examples where the first sketch or the first idea really stayed throughout all the way to the end. Most other projects, 99% of them, have a really long process where they start somewhere and end up somewhere else. I don't think iconicity per se is something that I personally am certainly not interested in that in itself. I think what we do appreciate is clarity of idea, also a clarity in expressing an idea. So, you know, for example, taking the pool, I just want people to really enjoy having fun in there, swimming and enjoying the silliness, if you will, of the shape. That it necessarily registers that it's also a smart thing, it's kind of secondary. It's important to me that it filters the river water and that facilitates it, but at the end of the day, it comes down to the very basicness of being there in your swimsuit and just swimming in clean river water. You don't have to rationalize it necessarily. There's a lot of complexity oftentimes built in those projects that isn't necessarily apparent. There's so many layers, from site to environmental aspect, to program, to client, to users. But we try to always be very clear, or kind of simplify the way we express those things.
One of the threads in your work seems to be an attitude about the environment, like filtering the water, wind turbines, just having, let's say, foliage and greenery as part of the project.
When we started our practice, it was right after the crash. And if you remember, the type of architecture that was happening before, whether it was China or Dubai, was pretty intense and a rather superficial level. It was always about the tallest building. There was definitely a culture of excess. So when we started our own practice, I think we were looking very much for a sense of purpose and bit of responsibility as what do we want to do. You know, oftentimes you are destroying by building something, you're destroying something natural or you're destroying something that's there. If what you're adding into the world doesn't make a difference, doesn't make it better, doesn't contribute in a positive way, then what's the point in doing it?
Before you were saying you have like art influences, part of it maybe are all these like different cultural or geographic influences in your work. You've also worked for a bunch of different architects. I'm wondering, all of these influences, how do you sort of deal with all of these things and kind of mix them together?
To me, everything I ever did was always sort of, there was always a logic to it, there was always a connection. I always enjoyed it about architecture. You don't have to look at it in a singular way, but it can offer you a multitude of experiences, basically, depending on what you're interested in. And I mean, we're young. I think everything we do is still a learning process, and we're still kind of testing things and trying and experimenting and just having fun with it. I think not losing the passion or kind of committing to the things that are important to us is still something that we try to keep an eye on. And actually, that's probably one of the hardest things in starting a practice. The moment you have employees, you have a commitment to your family. You have to keep a balance between not letting that commitment kind of override, right, your principles. So I think that was the most important learning curve, actually learning to say no to a lot of things and what kind of things to say no to and kind of just sticking to your guns and your visions.
Is there anything else that's happened like with a single project that were interpreted differently than you expected? Like any surprises along the way?
Again, I think the pool is probably the most surprising project in that sense. It's like a gift that keeps on giving. So we had this idea, we made a website with our friends from PlayLab. Then a friend of theirs picked up the website. It didn't even get to the point where we launched it or put it out. And overnight this website crashed. People just really got into it. And it was the first time to me that I saw something like that where people viscerally reacted to a piece of design or architecture. It happens a lot in fashion, in things that people are understanding a little bit better or relating in a more direct way. But I think in architecture it's rather rare to see that kind of reaction. And it keeps on happening to this day. I still can't believe how many people put their time, money, and effort behind a project and simply because they believe in the design. And you have people from all over the world, people who say, I'm never gonna be in New York, but this is a great idea, I believe in it. That was a huge revelation in many ways. It's like something you would only happen in your wildest dreams. Like, I've never witnessed that before, and I've never really expected something like that to happen.
It's a project where you were communicating with people that aren't architects, and I kind of love that point. Like, it sort of means that you have to communicate differently, make different representations, and now you're gonna go downstairs and give a lecture to architects mostly, I think. Thanks for the interview, and I'm glad you were able to visit us here at SCI-Arc.
Thank you, David.
Thanks.